Hello everyone, let's go ahead and continue our discussion on probability. Now, in our previous discussion, we talked about the flipping a coin trial with two outcomes in the universal set. If we repeated that trial 10 times, then we could come up with a frequency chart to then go ahead and establish the experimental probabilities of getting a head as well as getting a tail. Now, of course, when we went ahead and talked about the probability based upon a relative frequency, that of course gave us the experimental probability results. But what we want to do is we want to contrast that to theoretical probability, because this is what we're going to be working with much, much more. So if we go ahead and try to take a look at the relationship between the two, remember we said that the experimental probability is based upon the actual result of n trials, and we saw that here. Now the thing is our theoretical probability results, or just the probability of head and the probability of tail, is going to be based upon the assumption that the outcomes are equally likely to occur. So if we go ahead and take a look at flipping a coin, then we have heads and tails as the only two possible outcomes that we have. We're going to assume that those two possible outcomes are equally likely to occur, and therefore the probability of head should be 1/2 and the probability of tail should be 1/2 as well. Now the interesting thing is that for this particular situation of flipping a coin, as we flip the coin an infinite number of times, the nice thing is that our experimental probabilities of getting a head and a tail actually converge on the theoretical probability results of 1/2 and 1/2. So, in general then, for an event E containing equally likely outcomes, the probability of E is going to be the number of members of the event E divided by the total number of possible outcomes. Now, we're going to go ahead and use this notation here with the N representing the number, so the number of E and the number of elements in U. So let's go ahead and try to attach that to our specific example of the probability of a head. If we go ahead and take a look at the number of outcomes of heads in our universal set, there is only one outcome, so therefore it's a 1 divided by the total number of elements in our universal set, which is equal to 2, and that would be consistent also with the probability of T. So what we come out with then, we come out with some significant results. And these are the key results that we're going to have to be able to work with. And the first one says that any time that you have the probability of an event, that probability has to be greater than or equal to 0 and less than or equal to 1. Now, if we go ahead and think about the probability of an event being equal to 0, then that means that it's never going to happen. And the probability of an event being equal to 1 means that it's always going to happen. And therefore, the probability of E could be anywhere in between. Now, of course, hopefully that's very logically obvious that you cannot have negative probabilities and you cannot have probabilities that are going to be greater than 1. Now, we're also going to take a look at this, which is called the probability of E prime. And E prime is going to be the complementary event of E. So what we say then is that if you have the probability of an event occurring plus the probability of the event not occurring, then you should go ahead and add those two probabilities to be able to come up with 100% or the value of 1. So let's go ahead and put this all in context with a particular problem. And let's say, for example, we have 3 coins now. And we want to go ahead and determine what is the probability of getting 3 heads. Now, again, remember, when it comes to probability, we have to account for all the outcomes. So what we'll do in this particular situation is we'll go ahead and use a tree diagram. Here's our first trial, which is flipping the coin. Here's the second trial, which is flipping the coin again. And the third trial, which is flipping the coin the third time. Now notice that if we follow our paths along the branches of each one of the trees, then we're going to be able to come up with these particular outcomes here. Now, if I wanted to go ahead then and find the probability of getting 3 heads, well, that's the number of 3 heads divided by the total number of outcomes in our universal set. So if I go through all the outcomes in the universal set, There is only one situation where you actually come up with three heads, and it's right here. Oops, sorry, that's not correct. There's the three heads outcome. And if we go ahead and take a look at the total number of outcomes, well, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So therefore, the probability of coming out with three heads is going to be 1/8. Now, what is the probability of coming out with the complementary event, or not getting three heads? Well, the one thing that we could do, of course, is we could just go ahead and take a look at, well, what is the total number of outcomes where you don't have three heads, and divide that by the total number of outcomes that you have in your universal set. If I was to go ahead and take a look at that, well, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 outcomes that are not three heads divided by the total number of outcomes in our universal set, which is 7/8. Now, the other way that we could go ahead and calculate that, of course, is we could say that the probability of getting three heads plus the complementary event of not getting three heads is going to be equal to 1. So I know that the probability of not getting three heads is going to be equal to 1 minus the probability of getting three heads, and therefore I can still come up with the same result of 7/8. Okay, so let's go ahead and wrap up and summarize. So again, remember we started off first of all by calculating experimental probability using relative frequencies. But what we want to do is we want to be able to take a look at the theoretical probability of an event based upon the assumption that the outcomes are equally likely to occur. And based upon that, we can always go ahead and generalize to say that the probability of any event is going to be the number of those events in the universal set divided by the number of outcomes in the universal set. And we're able to go ahead and use some key results to be able to calculate theoretical probabilities. So we'll go ahead and take a look at more examples in class the next time that we'll meet, and we'll be able to go ahead and answer any questions that you have at that time. So see you then. Bye-bye.